at the Smithsonian National Postal Museum in Washington, D.C., across from Union Station, for the opening of the William H. Gross Stamp Gallery, which becomes the largest stamp gallery in the world.
The gallery is the largest stamp gallery in the world, and we have two strategies on this gallery. We want to take the collecting base and let them see very rare objects. But then what we want to do for families and school children is show them the beauty of stamps and the educational value of stamps. Stamps, the images on stamps, are the history, heritage, and heroes of the United States. Pure education, pure education. This morning, we had the Army and the family of Mr. McNerney, who won the Medal of Honor in the Vietnam War. He was a stamp collector. And he donated the Medal of Honor with the concurrence of the Army to the museum, and we have it up in the new stamp gallery. He's an amazing guy, and he did an incredible job in Vietnam, saving a lot of lives, but he was also a major collector. And it was very nice because we had the whole McNerney family here. We had a lot of the military people that served with him. We probably had about 350 visitors for the ceremony.
I had the distinct honor of serving with First Sergeant David H. McNerney from 1965 till 1967. During our training in Fort Lewis, Washington, there aren't too many of us that really got along with Top, as I will call him, because he was very strict. But after our very first firefight in Vietnam, we loved that man. He taught us so much. If we came into a certain situation, we did not have to ask each other, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? We had trained together for a year prior to going to Vietnam, and we knew how each other would react to certain situations. I am just so thankful that I had the honor and the privilege to know First Sergeant David H. McNerney.
Tell us about that experience in Vietnam.
In Vietnam? March, you mean as in March 22nd?
Yes.
Man, March 22nd was, we started out early in the morning, and there were just shots in the beginning, just started, and there were more shots, and pretty soon the firing is so intense that you can't hear anybody talking, everybody's laying down, and then the machine guns are going off, and when you think it can't get any louder, it gets louder and louder. The artillery starts coming in, and it's blowing all around us, and machine guns are going off, and men are screaming and yelling. And when this stuff is going on, Sergeant McNerney was in the back of us, and he came walking up giving encouragement to everybody. And he looks down, I'm down in a little gully, and he looks down at me and he gives me some encouragement. And I look up at him and he says, I'm going up to where the action's at. And he just went through the jungle and disappeared. And the rest is history. If it wasn't for that man, not one of us would be here today.
You made a lot to David. Those bonds that you formed are forever. You know that, I don't have to tell you. But I'm incredibly proud of what you represent and what you continue to represent to our soldiers of today. Our young men of today stand on the shoulders of those who came before them. They are able to do what they do today because of you. So thank you so much for that. I want to thank the Postmaster General. I want to thank you and all associated with this great day for taking David's collection and displaying it so everyone else can see it. So thank you so much for being here. And I want you to know, as always, I finish with, the strength of our nation is our army. The strength of our army is our soldiers. The strength of our soldiers is our families. And that's what makes this army strong. Steadfast and loyal. Thank you very much.
And now let's learn more about the new William H. Gross Gallery.
This gallery is the introductory gallery. Here you see the first postage stamp ever from 1840 from Great Britain, the penny black. And you see images of lots of stamps with great ideas, great stories, great designs. Well, the William H. Gross Gallery has seven different sections within it. Each one tells a different story. And here we're in a section that tells about mail and the purposes of mail, how it traveled, what went wrong along the way, how they got it delivered. And here's a great piece. Less than 10 pieces are known that survived from the Titanic. Tons of mail went underwater with the ship. But because the ship made a couple stops before it went across the Atlantic at Cherbourg and Queenstown, a couple pieces of mail were taken off for delivery. And this is one of those very rare examples with a Titanic postmark. We have two other great Titanic pieces. These keys are from the mail room of the Titanic. The mail room was on the side where the ship hit the iceberg, so it was flooded very quickly. And next to that is a pocket watch from one of the sea clerks. You can see the water stains, and you can see when it stopped. The ship actually sunk about 20 minutes later, but the crew, once they had the order to abandon ship, many jumped off the ship early, waiting for the help that they expected was on its way. Of course, they didn't make it. This is a block of four of the actual inverted Jenny, the most famous stamp in America and one of the most famous errors in the world. The Jenny biplane is upside down. It was printed that way in mistake when it went through the press the second time. There were only 100 inverted Jennies, one sheet, and then it was divided up. So getting four still intact is really special to see. This is the Gems of American Philately. This is the only envelope known postmarked on the 4th of July, 1776, America's birthday, and it's addressed to John Hancock. We have some incredible artifacts from 9/11. Because right next door to the World Trade Center was the Church Street Station Post Office that serviced the World Trade Center. So we have one of the mailboxes that was right there, and of course it got kind of beat up. And we have the fire hose nozzle that was used right outside the windows of the post office to help put out the fire. And we have pieces of mail that have been salvaged from the post office as well. All of these tell another side of the story of what happened with the World Trade Center. One of the exciting things when you come to the Postal Museum is you don't just look at the stamps in the National Philatelic Collection, but you can actually pick out six stamps and take them home to start your own collection. Or you can get on our computers and design your own stamp, even adding your own photograph. You can also go to one of our interactives and start a collection of stamps and send them home to yourself by email.
Nearly a century after it was first issued, America's most famous stamp, the misprinted 24-cent inverted Jenny, reinvents itself as a stamp collecting inverted Jenny $2 stamp souvenir sheet. The sheet of stamps were issued on September 22, 2013 to coincide with the Smithsonian National Postal Museum's opening of the William H. Gross Stamp Gallery, the largest stamp gallery in the world.
We're here this afternoon to dedicate a new version of the most famous stamp in American history, the inverted Jenny, a 1918 misprint that mistakenly showed a biplane flying the wrong way upside down. So we're going to dedicate the inverted Jenny stamp, and I'm going to introduce you to the Postmaster General. You know, I was looking at what was written, and I'm not going to use any of this. Pat Donahoe is an amazing guy. I know Pat a long time, for many years. He has one of the most difficult jobs in Washington, D.C. I don't know how he gets up in the morning, to be honest with you. He's got to bring consensus with Congress, which is almost impossible, as you guys know. Unions, mailing organizations, on and on and on, to try to build a business model for the future, for the Postal Service. And I don't know anybody else who is better suited for the job than Pat. He's an amazing guy. Pat Donahoe.
Good afternoon, everybody. Postal Service is very honored to be part of the entire Gross Stamp Gallery opening this weekend. And it's really an ideal setting for the dedication of the new version of America's most famous stamp, which is the upside down or inverted Jenny, which, as Alan said, accidentally was printed with the airplane upside down. Recently, and you heard Alan talk about some of the challenges we have, but recently an inverted Jenny was sold for almost $1 million. One stamp, $1 million. And people have said, geez, if you guys made that mistake again, that would really help you get out from the hole you're in. So, if you think about the stamp, it was a misprint, but from a postal service, it symbolizes the pioneering role that we have played in American history. When you think about our mission is to deliver mail to every address in America. And so we're constantly looking to increase, you know, the ability to speed things up and do it at the same time in a very efficient way. And that's why we have depended on every form of transportation you can imagine. We've used horseback. In fact, we've used horseback until probably about 30 years ago. Steamship, airplane. If it has legs, wheels, or wings, we probably use it to move mail one time or another. Now, not all the ideas worked. In New York City for years, we used to send mail around in pneumatic tubes, and that worked great when there was only a few letters. But once the mail volume picked up, the tubes didn't work so well anymore. And the other thing that we experimented with, and you will see it in the Gross Gallery, was missile mail. But that's probably best left unsaid as far as the outcome of missile mail. But fortunately, airmail turned out to be one of our most successful innovations. The service started in 1918, just 9 years. Think about this, 9 years after the Wright brothers took flight down in Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. And the first flight actually took off right down next to the Lincoln Monument on a very short piece of property. But when the inverted Jenny stamp actually went on sale, commemorating us with using airplanes to move the mail, the clerk who accidentally released it, rumor has it, had never seen an airplane, if you think about it, in 1918. So he probably didn't even know that the thing was flying upside down. But from a postal service perspective, by showing that air travel could be safe and useful, we helped create the American aviation industry, which went on to reshape the world. And this is a recurring theme in the postal history. If you go all the way back to Benjamin Franklin, as the first postmaster general, actually helped to establish what were called the post roads, from all the way from Maine down to Florida. In fact, US 1 was originally a post road, and that set the basis for a substantial portion of the highway system in the United States. And I'm proud to say that our dedication to innovation continues, because we never stop seeking ways to move mail faster and smarter. Postal Service today is recognized as a leader in optical character recognition, that whole technology, and that means that almost every piece of mail that's sorted and read for a delivery order goes through one of these pieces of equipment. In fact, that helps us to efficiently sort 6,000 pieces per second on a daily basis. We continue to pioneer new forms of mail transportation, including electric vehicles, fuel cell vehicles. We're on the cutting edge in a lot of those, and hopefully helping the United States to put those types of technologies going into the future. Our commitment to trying new things is rock solid, and the Postal Service is never going to stop trying to find faster and smarter ways to do our job.
It's a tremendous honor and privilege to be here to represent NASA and to also represent the coordination and cooperation between the Smithsonian. The National Postal Museum doesn't sound like a logical fit. It sounds more like the Air and Space Museum is where we would fit in, but there's an awful lot of stuff that NASA has done that has actually been commemorated on postage stamps. So the Postal Service, thank you very much. So we have a trifecta here, which is just perfect. The highlight, and as was mentioned by Cheryl, of the collection, at least from my bias standpoint, is the piece of mail postmarked on the moon. The only one. So this is really, really cool. This piece was created on August the 2nd, 1971, during the Apollo 15 mission. So after 3 days of hard exploring on the moon, it turns out that astronaut David Scott actually had the envelope and a little stamp. And he had two proof stamps, and that was my test to actually prove to Cheryl I was a philatelist, because I actually knew there were proofs, and canceled it on the surface of the moon. Now, it turns out, of course, if you've ever worn a spacesuit, and I haven't because I'm too old and I'm not the right type of person for that, they're really hard to work in. And so instead of just postmarking it once, it took two tries to get a nice, clean, you know, postmark the moon. It's really, really cool. The other thing that has an extra bonus points, he left thumbprints on the envelope from his spacesuit. And so, and I won't claim it's moon dust, but I suspect it is. So the same day that Scott actually made the postmark, this historic postmark on the moon, the post office sold the stamps to everyone in the country, and they're nice, beautiful stamps. There are myriads of objects, both stamps and postal items, that are on display, and a fair fraction of them, surprisingly so, actually commemorate NASA and NASA-like activities. So when you go up to the Gross Gallery, please take a look. And oh, by the way, to use an old sci-fi movie trope, watch the skies, look up, because there's some treat there that I will leave that as an exercise to the reader, as my academic colleagues would say. The very first NASA theme stamp was way back in 1960, and it was Echo 1, which was this big, huge balloon that was launched less than 18 months after the agency was formed. That's pretty impressive. And by my reckoning, there's about almost 60 stamps that either commemorate NASA missions or commemorate some activity that NASA is doing or wanted to do. And so we've had projects like the Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo missions, the specific missions themselves, Apollo 8, Apollo 11, and some of the shuttle missions, and of course the science. And as an astronomer, of course, I like the science aspect of it. So there are stamps for Hubble, Voyager, Mariner, the Mars Pathfinder, which was the little wee tiny rover that went on Mars, and others.
So I'm batting cleanup this afternoon, and my job really is to be a little bit of local color and talk a little bit about Washington, D.C. and its relationship to the inverted Jenny. You know, we've spoken a lot, and if you've been up to the gallery, you've read a lot about how inverted Jenny is an international icon now, recognized by collectors and non-collectors all over the world as the most famous postage stamp ever issued. But although Jenny now belongs to the world, her story really begins and ends in Washington, D.C. Washington has special, unmatched connections to this international icon. The stamp was designed and printed here, of course, at the Bureau of Engraving and Printing, and it was sold to the public at a post office on New York Avenue, barely a mile away from the Bureau, to a young bank cashier named William Roby. And news of Roby's discovery spread through Washington's fairly small philatelic community like a wildfire. It set off a wild goose chase as collectors descended on post offices all over the city, including this building, trying to find additional sheets of the error. Needless to say, they didn't find any. The post office department was looking for inverted Jennies too. Today, the post office revels in the legend and the myth of Jenny and celebrates it, but it didn't seem that way to them at the time. The officials in charge of implementing the airmail service feared that the image of upside down planes on the stamps would be seized upon by the service's many detractors. There were detractors to the airmail service at the time, and a number of them happened to be congressmen. So postal inspectors were dispatched with orders to get those stamps back. Meanwhile, the lucky purchaser had gone to Hamilton Coleman's stamp shop, which was on 7th Street in the Penn Quarter here in Washington. And there, a small group of worthies were assembled to see the stamps. Among them, the Smithsonian Institution's first two curators of philately, Joseph Levy and Catherine Manning. Many years later, Roby told the story that when he phoned Catherine Manning and told her that he had purchased the sheet of inverts, she told him that she didn't believe him and she wanted to see them. And that's why he went to the shop that night where they were all assembled so they could behold the sheet of stamps and see for themselves. And Roby, many years later, said, "I wonder why Mrs. Manning didn't believe me." Well, she believed him, but she was a smart lady. She wanted to see them. You know, there's no way to know for sure, but probably only a dozen or so people ever saw the full intact sheet of 100 stamps before it was broken up and sold to collectors. And those two Smithsonian curators were among the chosen few. After that meeting, Roby was besieged by collectors, hounded by relentless postal inspectors who turned up at his job and at his work trying to convince him to give them back the stamps. And he didn't quite know what to do, so he did the only thing he could think to do. And that is, he rode Washington, D.C.'s streetcars aimlessly for hours. No special destination, just waiting for dark so he could return home to Harvard Place under cover of darkness and stow his briefcase safely under the mattress. He and his wife slept with the briefcase under their mattress for several nights until Roby finally smuggled the sheet out of the capital city aboard a train from Union Station just next door and sold it on to a dealer in Philadelphia. It would be four decades before any of the Jenny stamps would return to Washington, D.C. When the Smithsonian received its first copy, a gift from the famous stamp dealers, the Weil brothers, in 1957. So 95 years ago, countless collectors descended on this building in search of Jenny inverts, and every single one of them left bitterly disappointed. But not so today. Upstairs in the William H. Gross Stamp Gallery, you will see seven of them on display. And down here, you can visit the USPS stamp sales and leave with as many of them as you want. It's your lucky day.
Inverted Jenny stamp was a real rarity in the Postal Service. In 1918, we printed up 100 sheets and sold one. And that one sheet was sold and was resold and sold again, and to the point where one stamp was sold recently for almost $1 million. What happened was, when they were printing the stamps at the Bureau of Engraving and Printing, people were working around the clock on a lot of things to do with World War I. So the story has it that the printer was very tired and had never seen an airplane before, and he actually printed the thing not knowing it was upside down, and somebody stopped it, and then they straighten it out, but somehow they get into the system.
The inverted Jenny stamp is probably the most popular stamp in U.S. history. It was created in 1918, a day before the first airmail flight, and in a rush to produce it, one of the stamps was printed upside down by mistake, and they did that because they had to run the stamp sheet through a printing machine twice, once for the red image, another time for the blue image, and the sheet just got turned upside down when it went through. Well, the stamps go to the post offices. In fact, here in Washington, D.C., one sheet of 100 stamps bared this image of the upside down Jenny. All the others were flying right side up. The clerk that sold this sheet had never seen an airplane before, and the collector that bought it from a sheet of 100, and you think back then, 1918, 24 cents a stamp times 100, that's roughly $24. And by the way, that's $3.71 in today's dollars, so that's still a pretty good darn deal for postage today. He sold the sheet not knowing the airplane was upside down. The collector was just emphatic about it. He asked to buy another sheet, and the clerk got kind of suspicious. He went to his supervisor, and the supervisor saw what the problem was and says, "No, don't sell any more sheets." Well, the gentleman bought the stamp, and in fact, the Postal Inspection Service tried to buy it back from the next day, but he refused to do it. Long story short, this sheet, the one sheet of 100, nearly all of them have been recovered. They're the most popular rare stamps in U.S. history. A block of four sold for $2.5 million. One of the stamps sold for nearly $1 million, so it's incredibly popular.
So when you actually go to purchase this stamp, you'll find that it is sealed in shrink wrap. And this is the first time we've ever done this in Postal Service history. And what we're doing is we're trying to recreate that excitement of finding something unknown when you're going to purchase this stamp. So that is our reason for doing it. That's what we can talk about now. But I can tell you that there is going to be some exciting developments about this stamp coming up.
Today with us is Ben Franklin, and would you like to tell our audience the history of Ben Franklin with the post office?
Well, it's a long history, but I am honored to be here, and it is also exciting to see that the Postal Service is still in operation, and hopefully it will be in many years to come.
Now, were you the first Postmaster General?
I was under the Continental Congress, but obviously there were postmasters before me under the British rule, but yes, I am the first Postmaster General under the Continental Congress.
And do you want to fill our audience in about the inverted Jenny stamp?
Well, the inverted Jenny stamp was many years after me. I believe it was in 1918 when that stamp came out. And obviously it was a mistaking of printing, which I don't do. And I believe that they are reissuing it today in honor of the inverted Jenny. So that happens in printing. It was just an inverted plate for printing, which I am very familiar with.
And it's rare because, what, only 100 were ever printed? Or
that's right. I believe a sheet of just 100 were printed, and I believe each individual stamp is close to $500,000 today, I believe. So I do not own one, but I wish I printed them.
Well, thank you, and come down to Washington, D.C. to the Smithsonian National Postal Museum.
We issued the stamp in conjunction with the new Gross Gallery. We cut the ribbon on that last night, opened it up for the public today. It pretty much doubles what we have here at the Postal Museum. It's great. I would encourage people to come in. The thing we're really excited about is the fact that it's a street-level gallery, so now people will know where the Postal Museum is. The other special treat, at night when you go by, the windows light up and there are all some beautiful stamps.
Customers have until November 22, 2013 to obtain the first day of issue postmark by mail. Affix the stamps to envelopes of your choice, address the envelopes to yourself or others, and place them in a larger envelope addressed to Stamp Collecting Inverted Jenny Stamp, Special Cancellations, P.O. Box 92282, Washington, D.C. 20090-2282. After applying the first day of issue postmark, the Postal Service will return the envelopes through the mail. There is no charge for the postmark up to a quantity of 50. For more than 50, there is a 5-cent charge per postmark. All orders must be postmarked by November 22, 2013. I'm Kristal Hart reporting from Washington, D.C., the Smithsonian National Postal Museum. Hope you've enjoyed the show, and thanks for watching.